time. Welcome. So I thought it'd be nice for us to get to know one another prior to all this didactic stuff that we'll sleep through. So why don't we start in the front and then we'll go to the back. Is that okay?
I'm Alan Blank, Sparta. I teach at the University of Wisconsin in law, bioethics, and Jewish studies.
My name is Ashraf Youssef, and I work in the pharmaceutical industry in the area of safety, and I have a long interest in the area of bioethics and medical research. I have actually published material about this topic in Egypt in the 90s, and to talk about that more.
Let's get this right one going.
Mohammed Fahid, I'm an internist in Milwaukee.
Great.
Shoaib Rashid, I'm a medical student at West Virginia School of Osteopathic Medicine, and we're presenting a topic tomorrow, which I'll
share. Asma Amini, I'm a pediatrician in Columbus, Ohio, and I'm doing a fellowship in bioethics.
Jim Warrens, I'm a physician in palliative medicine at Mohammed's Medical Center in Brooklyn.
Hello.
And I'm on the bioethics committee, the associate director of the bioethics committee. We have rather a large Muslim population in our area in Brooklyn.
Yeah, I was at Weill Cornell a long time ago, and actually I think it's a rotation at my mom's.
Yes.
I'm from the UK. I'll be going to be speaking tomorrow. I'm currently training. Writing about it, currently doing pain, which is the emergency medicine side of things. I've been working with my spouse for about 4 or 5 years now.
I'm Nick Guinness. I'm a recent graduate of undergrad College of St. Olaf in Minnesota, and I recently took several courses on bioethics and comparative Christian Islamic ethics. And with these two.
Hi, I'm Nancy Romanchuk. I'm a hospice nurse.
Jeannie Morsa, I'm a chaplain at Northwestern Memorial Hospital downtown and the co-chair of the Medical Ethics Committee. I also teach in the medical school, teaching the ethics area.
Linda Merriman, also from Columbus, Ohio, cardiology fellow at the Ohio State University. And next year will be a heart failure and heart transplantation fellow.
I'm Kid White from Atlanta, Georgia. I practice family medicine.
I'm Mikhail Ramadan, full-time emergency medicine, and also bachelor's in command from Maxwell Top Chicago.
I'm
Adnan Zucker.
I'm an undergrad student at Northwestern in Evanston.
I'm Felicia Mwalim. I just finished my master's in bioethics at Columbia University in New York.
My name is Mohammed Rahman. I'm a biomedical engineer, but currently I'm working in the Department of Emergency Medicine at U of C.
I'm Helen Chappell, and I'm from Creighton University at the Center for Health Policy and Ethics. I teach ethics to nursing students, and I also teach a course on rescue and transplant. My research interest is death and dying, especially dying in the hospital.
I'm Elizabeth Sartell. I'm a PhD student at the Divinity School in Islamic Studies here at the University of Chicago.
Hello, assalamu alaikum. My name is Eva. I am a recent graduate of Loyola. I'm just starting med school in the fall. So I'm just here to learn more before I start.
I'm Shazia Burka. I'm currently a student at Midwestern University, Chicago College of Pharmacy.
Mayim Ashuk. I'm a medical physicist at radiation oncology here at UFC. I teach research ethics mainly to graduate students in the medical program. And I like asking each other.
At least one person.
My name is Diyad Akhtar. I'm a cardiologist, and I have a particular interest in the bioethics as well as the organ donation transplantation based on the religious the ethics. And I'm interested in learning and teaching. In this bioethics as well as the organ transplantation, particularly because my specialty is the heart, so that's dear to me.
My name is Sarah Siddiqui. I just finished med school at UIC and I'm about to start my residency in pediatric neurology in law
I'm Azam Zarif. I'm from Houston, Texas. I am the social media guy, inshallah, for IIM, and that's it. I've worked in biostatistics and cancer research before I went into starting a hedge fund.
Thank you all. So,
is the hedge fund about the organ donation?
We can always work on that.
So a few housekeeping items before we begin. So basically, you all received your materials at the registration desk. In your materials, you have a packet. At the end, there's this insert that has a few things within it. The most important thing within that is the evaluation forms. So I want to kind of just, I know this is in the packet, but I want to mention that we actually need evaluations from everybody. That's a way for us to improve the material that we're going to present. And for those who are getting CME credit, we need that as well. So there's two evaluation forms. One of them is for our internal purposes, the other is actually to give to the CME credit agency. But it doesn't matter whether you use CME or not, you have to fill all those out. And once you return them to the desk, you'll get your certificate of participation or your certificate of CME, or if you're an EPNO member, you'll get that online. So you still need to hand it in. As you see the refreshments outside, the reason the doors are closed right now, they're moving them to the area where we're going to sit for lunch. For those who want to sit here for lunch, that atrium up here. There's a microwave, and then there's going to be box lunches on that table. You can also sit anywhere upstairs in the building, nicer space. There's obviously couches upstairs. You can go outside, whatever you'd like to do. There are some classes and tests going on, so just be mindful of that during the day. And for today, those who are going to Friday prayers, we're going to walk over. So after the lecture ends at 12:40, about 5 minutes to do whatever you need to do, 5-7 minutes, we'll walk over. It's about a 7-minute walk. Last year, it was a torrential downpour when we were walking. I am hoping that today that won't be the case. I don't control that. So that's that. Before we begin, again, you know, so this is part of a, you know, there's a tradition that says that if you don't thank the people, you're not thankful to God. So there's a lot of people behind all this work that's being done, and I like to notice and acknowledge them. But what I really ask is for all the staff that are upstairs, they're all volunteering their time. So be mindful of that. Tell them thanks. I don't say that enough to them, but just say we appreciate what you're doing, you know, coming here on the weekend for us. So just remember that and give them some sort of gratitude. And then we're going to Bingham. So basically, the Institute of Islamic Medicine that is hosting this program resides in these two axes. And the first axis here, let's see if the pointer works. There we go. So the first axis I think of is in between the seminary and the academy. And that is we're looking at the ways in which Islam is understood by seminarians, right? Those who are the standard bearers of the tradition, those who embody the tradition, and the academy, where Islam and Muslim peoples are a source of study, right? There are a group of people that are intellectually interesting, and we look at them. But the way in which Islam is understood here sometimes doesn't match up with the way that Islam is understood here. And for the Institute of Islamic Medicine, we want to kind of bridge that gap. On the other axis is the axis is the relation between the Muslim community and the healthcare system around what constitutes American Muslim health. So the ways in which Muslims understand their tradition influences their health behaviors. And that influences the healthcare challenges they might face in the healthcare system. So you want to bridge the gap between the community, which is the bare repository of behaviors and actions and understandings embodied with Islam, and the healthcare system that is seeking to provide culturally competent, culturally sensitive care. So that's the other axis we reside. But our methodology largely is one of practical translation, right? Translating concepts and terms between the community and the academy and the seminary and the healthcare system. So all around, we're translating concepts between each other. And basically, what ends up happening is conversation, right? So this is not, and today, you're going to see that we're going to be involving ourselves in a conversation. There are not fully right answers at any time. No one owns the authority to say what is Islamic, what is not, but we want to come together with a greater appreciation for what those ways in which people are interacting with Islam, the ways that in which they interact with Islam influences their behaviors. So the methodology is this one. We bring together Muslim scholars, Islamic studies experts, medical and social scientists around the table to fill the knowledge gaps around Islamic dialogue. And the part of that is after that work is done, we host intensive workshops like this one that kind of talks about both the theory right, or the theology of Islam, as well as on-the-ground healthcare behavior surveys that show what's occurring at the ground level and the ways that people are interacting with their tradition. So with that in mind, I'm going to kind of put some disclaimers out there. So you're all here, you're a captive audience. You're not going to leave here with any mastery in anything. Largely, and this is from last year, people said you leave with more questions than answers. So be prepared for that. Are you going to leave with questions as opposed to answers? However, you're going to leave here gaining some conceptual literacy in what is Islamic bioethics. I hope that you will leave here equipped with a greater understanding of the ethical legal debates surrounding organ donation. That's our focus this year. And the two people here are going to be responsible for that, not me. So, Abadah and Shoaib, if you don't leave with that, tell us their problem. They didn't do a good job. And then, actually, in the end, I hope we create a community that comes together with a deep interest in studying the intersections between Islam, healthcare, and bioethics. Our approach is one where we're trying to balance many different things. Right? So we're trying to balance on the level of knowledge, theoretical knowledge and practical knowledge. Right? On a presentation level, we're going to have some didactics, but there will be space within the workshop for narrative and case-based discussions. You were all asked, I hope, I was told that you were, to submit cases if you want to discuss them during our case discussions. And if you didn't, then we'll have a free lunch. We won't talk about anything, but if you did, then we'll have something to talk about during that time. Lastly, the discipline folks I hear will kind of rotate between theology, law, and sociology. And with that in mind, I'm going to give you a very brief overview of how these lectures string together, so you get a sense of what's happening. So day one, you started. I'm going to talk about the actors and material of Islamic bioethics. It's a practical lens. When you're looking and trying to understand what Islamic bioethics is or is not, you're looking for material online or you're looking for material in books, you need to understand the actors, who's in that space, and what material they're producing. After that, we're going to start doing a deep dive into different sort of concepts. The first talk here is going to be about constructing Islamic bioethics, where I'm going to take a theological lens. I'm going to bring forth concepts from moral theology in Islam and epistemology to kind of think about the normative, what that means. And you're going to be engaging in that discussion because I have three questions for that lecture. And what you give back is how the lecture's going to go. If there's no response to these questions, then we're not going to have anything to talk about. So then later on today, you're going to have Professor Aidu speak about tasawwuf and fiqh. These are terms in Islamic tradition, right? So we speak about that from a legal lens. And lastly, at the end of the day, I think it actually is the most interesting discussion that can go on for many, many hours if you let it. But really, is you're going to have an individual who's going to speak about all these concepts from theology and law, and just think about a simple question around what is the obligation for a Muslim to seek medical treatment? And you will see all these concepts coming together and more, and how that simple question is answered from a theological and legal perspective. Tomorrow, we're going to get into the material that you probably all hear for, which is around organ donation ethics. So, in the beginning, we're going to have another sort of practical lens. Dr. Mark Siegler is going to speak about ethical issues in living organ transplant. Then after that, we're going to have Susan Cochran present sort of the process and procedures of organ donation from a practical sense. Then as I mentioned, and as they mentioned here, Abadah and Shoaib are going to give a 3 hours to speak about the Islamic perspective and how on organ donation and how Muslims on the ground understand that, and then how we try to improve or enhance their understanding of organ donation or actually get them to donate their organs. At the end of the day, we're going to move from a Sunni lens, so what I've spoken about and these guys will speak about are Sunni lens, and I'll explain that in a second, to a Shi'i lens. So they're two different, as you may know, two different sects in Islam that have different theological constructs. The Sunni world is what I come from and I'm most familiar with, but we can't ignore the Shi'i lens either. So in the afternoon, Ilham Rashki is going to speak about the Shi'i lens, both in legal doctrine and again anthropology of what's going in Iran, what's going on in Iran. It's a very interesting case scenario of organ market, or organ market, where people are compensated. And day three, so you might say it's very light, but actually it isn't very light. So you're going to have a physician speak about, from a practical lens, what's the role of Muslim physicians in this discourse. And then, basically, we're going to have a case discussion and a conceptual review. So whatever we've tried to understand the last 2 days, the first 2 days, we're going to go over that in some detail at the end there. So you leave here with some enhanced literacy. That's the goal. So why this why this topic? So one answer is simple. Last year we did a sort of conceptual review, and there were three topics that came up that we want to talk about. One was end of life, one was organ donation, and the other was the patient-doctor relationship. So we said, we'll pick organ donation. But here is some data I want to present to you from work I've done in Berkeley. And so I want to ask you to kind of guess these answers here, all right? So this was a survey I did in Michigan from mosques. So our sampling strategy was to go to mosques, and we looked at mosques. We went to six mosques, two African-American mosques predominantly, two Arab-American and two South Asian. And that's how you get about 100 people. And we asked a simple question as part of the survey. Is it justifiable to donate my organs after I die? And on a 4-point scale. So, now audience participation starts from this point forward. I want you all to guess what the breakdown here would be. You could say I'm going to do binary, I'm going to say I'm going to agree, disagree, or you can say I'm going to tell you each one of these categories. So let's start with on the agree side, just collapsing agree, 3 and 4, what percentage do you guys think was agree? 70%. 70? 70? Okay. 20. 20. 70, 20. Okay. Other thoughts? 45. Okay. Any other thoughts? 30%. Okay. So you have 70, 20, so basically you have all the spectrum. You just have to cover everything. So what we found was this. And then here's the study. So you had nearly a split, if you look at this, right? So you had about 50% and 50% on each spectrum. And we looked at one of the predictors of this behavior, of this attitude. And we found that people who viewed difficulties in life as punishment from God, right, had a decreased odds, meaning that they were less likely, in a sense, to believe deceased organ donation was justified. That was the only religious predictor that we had. Other measures of religiosity, so they recorded practice-based measures like go to the mosque and pray, or they had certain intrinsic religiosity, how important is religion in my life. We had other measures. None of them were associated with organ donation attitude. What was further interesting, I didn't underline this here, was that age, sex, country of origin, health status, trust in the healthcare system, none of these were associated with this attitude. Yes.
Did people give you the reasons why they went one way or the other?
Sorry?
Did they explain why they chose one way or the other?
It was a cross-sectional survey, so we didn't have that ability. There was no right response.
That's it.
So we had several measures for religiosity. We wanted to, basically, the survey was aiming at looking at attitude and religiosity, right? So healthcare attitudes and religiosity, with some core barriers, which is trust in the healthcare system. But this is all we found. Go ahead, Dr.
I think the answers, one way or another, depends upon the lack of or the presence of knowledge about Islamic permissibility in the majority of people who go to the masjid, and then they see whether it's permissible or not.
Mm-hmm.
And the majority of the people who that you see in average mosque, they do not have the adequate knowledge whether it's permissible or not. So they just make a guesswork in general, and whenever there's a problem or some disaster happens, right away they go to the imam, who's reading the prayer, who may or may not be familiar with that information, and he will just say,
you think this is the median here, variable here, the real variable, this is all confounding, but the real variable here is whether Islam thinks, if they understand what the Islamic views are about permissibly or impermissibly. That's what you're positing, right?
Yes.
Yes. So good. So you get a sense of why you want to look at this workshop then? Because of your hypothesis, right? That if you have increased awareness of what the legal perspectives are, you might be able to move this potentially one way or the other, or leave it where it is. It might be justified, which you'll find out tomorrow. On the other hand, now the other African-American Muslims here are physicians, right? So work here, we did a national survey of American Muslim physicians through the Islamic Medical Association of America, a random sample. A tenth of their membership. And we asked these several questions. So now instead of giving me answers, I want you to read through them and think about yourself what your answers would be, okay? Then I'll give you the percentages. first question is just a simple, right? Similar to what the lady got. Right, so about permissibility, then there's a question about whether they're registered as organ donation. This is sort of an ethical question about necessity trust. So I'm going to give you the answers, and then I want to hear what you all think of these answers, or what strikes you as this works. Okay. What do you think of that? Huh?
We're all pretty confident.
We're all pretty confident in Islamic Bukhari. Okay, so for those who are not physicians here, does this surprise you? Do you think it should be higher or lower? Those who are not physicians.
Well, I always believe that you can donate at least while you're alive, but afterwards is when it gets a little gray area, as far as I'm concerned.
Okay, so we didn't do the deceased versus live.
So I mean, I would have said yes if you asked me that question straight up. I would have said yes too. So it doesn't.
So it doesn't surprise me. Okay, good. So now this second piece.
That doesn't surprise me.
How come?
Because I think people are afraid to go there. You know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
say
I
more.
Let me also apply. This is not a clinical question. This is a human response.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter if you're a physician or not.
Well, the first question isn't a clinical question either.
Well, no, the first question is because you are clinically trying to say, or I guess the second question is, as I mentioned, it's a person. It's yourself.
Yeah. Could you read the questions a little bit?
Sure,
it's hard to see.
This is: are you a registered organ donor?
Okay. And the first question was?
In Islamic, in your understanding, does Islamic bioethics and law permit organ donation? Sorry.
What is the second question? Sorry.
Second question is, are you a registered organ donor? So the first, so here's ultimately what surprised me, potentially, right? So you have physicians who are involved in the healthcare system. It's not surprising that many of them believe this is permissible. I don't know if that's Islamic views or not, but I'm sure many people think organ donation is a good thing. So that might be reflecting their idea. And mapping down to Islam. But even given that, the fact that two-thirds of them do not sign up as organ donors says something between the theoretical knowledge and the practical. There is some problem. Yes, go ahead.
Do you know what the rates of registering for organ donation are among
none.
A general population and physicians in general?
Right. So I don't know physicians. I know that it's about, depending on the ethnicity, so they say that, you know, for example, I think the highest in the United States is 70%, I think. That's in some Caucasian communities that they found in community surveys. I don't know if there's a national database. But then they find that the negative predictors are African-American, low educational status, immigrant status. Go ahead.
Well, I mean, I wonder if this is specific to organ donation or a lot of advice that physicians give their patients, like, do you have a living will, do you have a cancer victim? They might not have themselves
on the other side. I see. Okay, good. So now this is, I'll read this because we were expecting this to be like this, but I'll read this. So this is now, for physicians, a clinical quote-unquote question. So you have a patient, a Muslim patient, who has chronic renal failure on hemodialysis for the last 10 years. The patient's condition is deteriorating because of frequent catheter infections, and that patient's physician recommends a kidney transplant. So the first question asked of the physician is kidney transplantation, in this case, a medical necessity? Who says yes? Okay. So the second question, that was less than half, by the way. And the rest of you didn't do anything. So this could be a medical analysis, a life threat.
You didn't ask yes the other way.
I didn't ask the other way. I think the yes is important. And I'll tell you why. But so is continued human analysis a life threat? Yes. Okay. And then that's less than medical necessity. So more people in this room thought it was medical necessity than those who thought it was life threat. And the question simply is put, if you're the treating physician, would you recommend transplant? And that's more hands than either of these. Okay. So you have 92% of our sample believed it was a medical necessity. 65% believed it was a life threat. And 97% said they would recommend transplant. Does that surprise anyone?
to say that many people thought that that continued hemodialysis was a life threat is surprising to me based on how many people are on dialysis.
Right. So our interest in this question was whether these two things are equated by physicians, medical necessity and life threat. Okay? And also, what of these two questions, what predicts this attitude? So since this is a huge number here, we've been doing any of those analyses, right? We have 97%. There's a very small sample that's saying it's not. But I just thought the descriptive here is interesting, where you have what you just, I just said, right? There's a large percentage of people who think this is a life threat, but we know in today that there are people in the hemodialysis for a long time.
And right. They're not considered sick.
Right, yeah, right. I mean, right, so this is a chronic condition that is managed, at least in some areas of the world, very well for a long time period. So the fact that they think that people living for 10, 15, 10 years already, right, is a life threat tells you that what's going on for 10 years. Right? If it was a life threat, they'd still remain for 10 years on dialysis. So my point only was kind of giving you a sense of why this topic. I think there is some, potentially, something between theoretical understanding, theoretical attitude, and practical. And here, there is something here, I think, between this idea of life threat and medical necessity. And so we want to talk about those concepts, and you'll see those concepts explained today and tomorrow. Okay, so that's
question. Yes. That
these
numbers compare to physicians,
physicians'
attitude versus Muslim physicians?
This is the Muslim physician's
attitude. How it's comparing to general physician attitude would be
It would be good to know. I don't have a survey on that. There are community samples, so we don't have national samples of physicians in the United States. So with that said, that sets the stage for what's going to come next. If there are any questions, I want to answer them now. Yes?
I found the phrasing of hemodialysis as life threat confusing.
Okay.
Kidney disease is a life threat.
Right.
Hemodialysis is a partially successful response to that life threat, and transplantation may be a superior response in the particular case. So were I asked to complete that, I'd be quite puzzled as to how to understand it.
Very good. So before this set of scenarios, we actually have a definition. So I didn't present that because the slide would fit it. But we say life threat means this, right? And medical necessity, that we left up to them because they're physicians. So that confusion, hopefully, would be a little bit, late. Go ahead.
Well, you know, Humana has a position statement on organ donation, right?
Yes.
So the assumption might be that people, the physicians who are part of Humana might be aware of that, and that might influence that 85%. So it might be interesting also to look at non-Humana Muslim physicians.
Very good. If we can get a sample.
Right. I mean, if you have the people there, I'm saying they do have a position statement.
Very good. You'll find out later. I'll present some data about what those position statements mean to this group at all, or they don't mean anything to this group. So I'm going to take one question and we'll move on. I'll take two questions and we'll move on. Go ahead.
My first question is, can you zoom the slide so that we can read it?
I wish I could, but I don't think I can. We can try in the break. I can try to see if the guy can adjust this and see if it's bigger.
The other comment was...
That was
the
one.
Yeah.
You want to take a second question?
No, not the question. The other comment was the preference for the transplantation is based on quality of life instead of on being on the dialysis. It's a quality of life what they choose for.
No, so there's a lot of complexity that's missed here. I was just setting up the fact I think there's some interesting things going on here, which sets the stage for this workshop. That's all. We can talk about analyses. I want to do some further analyses on other predictors here and not look at this question, but look at this question. Actually, our lab is going to try to do that. So we're going to look at that further. Stay tuned, yes, please.
One single point, and that is that perhaps question A has an influence on question B.
Yes. Are you...
Because you asked the other one first. They already... Their heads are somewhere.
In this sample, we didn't have enough ability to do, that testing, right? So we switched the order. Because I'm doing a split sample. The sample's already small. It's 41% response rate. So all that stuff would be wonderful. This is why I asked Dr. Usman here to create that sample of Muslim physicians, and I can do a lot more work. All right. So let's move on. So here's the first lecture. Now I'm going to start timing myself. So you guys tell me what time do I have till finish from your agenda? When's it in?
10:15.
10:15? Okay. So I have 45 minutes. I'm going to give myself 35. That's 38. Okay, here we go. All right, so the Act of Materials of Islamic Bioethics. So just take it from me that Islamic bioethics is a newly birthed field which kind of has interest from many corners, but there really is a lack of clarity in what constitutes the Islamic, right? And we're going to talk about that in my second talk after this. Also, there are questions of the Islamic piece is contested, the bioethics piece is also contested. What is bioethics? Who are the domain experts in bioethics? What is the scope of bioethics, right? Public health ethics to sort of clinical care ethics. So that is also an interdisciplinary, multidisciplinary field, and that content also publicizes what is the growing field of Islamic bioethics. So contestation over Islamic, not sure what the scope is of bioethics. So that's the field. And when you look at the field and you start reading in the field, you'll find that there's a lot of conceptual ambiguity and lack of clarity, right? So simple terms such as what's right and wrong, or what's forbidden and what's corrupt and good, these are all confused. Different people writing use different terms, and they don't mean the same thing. I'm sorry, they use the same terms, they don't mean the same thing. And then you'll find at the practical end, right, when physicians or healthcare systems or others want to just get the material and apply it, it misses the mark because it doesn't address the kind of question they have at hand. So these things, gaps and things undressed. So the question for you all is, who needs or searches for Islamic bioethics guidance? What sorts of individuals or what sorts of categories of individuals? Question. The hospice who? So that would be healthcare providers, social workers, so the clinical care spectrum. Okay, others.
Patients.
Patients themselves. Good. Others.
Imams. Because people usually ask imams. For these matters.
Okay.
And not only organization, but even like many years ago when I was a student, even blood transfusion was a problem.
Okay.
And like even the family members will disappear the moment you mention it, are there any donors?
Okay. So religious leaders are looking for guidance, yeah. And so they themselves will look for guidance, to give guidance. Great. All right. Others?
The community at large.
So we have patients.
Like everybody who's very involved in a certain point in their life when a decision is best for themselves or their family.
Can I record you for our marketing video? That everybody?
Yes.
Everybody. So now we've left there.
Every innocent person that has to decide, because sometimes the driver is usually, sometimes it's the family. So
okay.
You may end up with people who will not know what does that mean to make a decision on person, other person's. What's ethical for us?
So like surrogate decision makers,
exactly.
Right? So it wouldn't be just the patient themselves, people who are involved, their family members. Very good. So then the question becomes, second question is, who are the consumers of Islamic bioethics? Are they different in any way? So we talked about people who need it or search for guidance, but are there other groups that are consuming that material?
Okay.
All of you in this room, right? From whatever discipline you are, you're consuming material that's put out there, right? And then some of you are researchers, some of you are involved in clinical care, some of you are just general interest, right? So there's an overlap, but not necessarily a full overlap. So I listed these here. We're going to skip the slide. I think you're doing the same thing. Maybe policymakers. So I'll tell you, particularly our organ donation here. Right, so policymakers in non-Muslim majority nations or Muslim majority nations might be wanting to know what are the guidelines on organ donation so they can create policies around that for the healthcare system. So, what's the slide? So now, who are the producers of Islamic bioethics? And you're all going to start writing a little bit.
Scholars.
What scholars?
Religious scholars.
Sorry?
Religious scholars.
My handwriting's going to be worse than that.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm just doing it because it's a habit. Go ahead.
Legal.
People
legal.
Make a lot, legal.
Lawyers.
Lawyers.
Okay, lawyers. Others?
Physicians.
Physicians, very good. And these, if there are DOs in the room, I assume soon you are there. Don't worry about it. All right, others?
The chaplain?
Chaplains? Chaplains?
Okay.
So we have religious scholars. So you meant something different than chaplains? You said legal law scholars, right? So I'm going to just put chaplains here. Is that okay? Okay, so you said no, okay, not okay. Okay. Others? I'll take two more.
Actually, it should be a combination of the medical doctors who have the degree in Islamic law also, or vice versa. It has to be the two combined together, because just the legal scholars without knowledge of medicine or the doctor without the knowledge of Islamic law, it doesn't work one alone. It has to be combined, the two.
I fully agree. So you're going to have people who kind of maybe even lawyers and chaplains at the same time.
Yes.
But I just want to get disciplines.
Yes.
Right?
I would hope that patients and families would somehow inform this.
Would inform this or be producing it?
It would be lovely if they produce it, but certainly have
okay.
a say, be part of the team.
All right, good. So if I were in your seat, coming to this talk, or thinking about something about this, I might just go to Google first. So I'm going to kind of dissect this for a second. So you put in Google Islamic Biotics Organ Donation, and you get these three articles, the Pulse Scholarly articles. So Google decides as a scholar, by the
yeah.
way. And it says, you can't read this, but I'm going to tell you who these are because it's going to be important later on. And it might match up to this here. So you have an article by Abdullah Daab, who is a good friend of Dr. Khitabi's. Where is he? Right? So I'm going to introduce yourself. You're eating. He's the secretary for the Biotics Committee, National Biotics Committee in Oman. So he's coming to us from Oman. And Dr. Daab, so that's Dr. Daab. And you have Muhammad Ghali, who's a PhD Islamic studies person. You have Fahad Muazzam, who's a physician in Pakistan. And then she also did a PhD in religious ethics from UVA. Okay? But now look at, so you have Islam and organ donation from Medscape, no author. You go there, you'll find this no author as well. You have this workshop, mine is it. Okay, then you have a slide set. When you go here, you'll find that's a physician slide set. You have a PDF here from Kamal, who is a religious studies scholar. And then you have this paper, The Interplay Between the Muslim Organ, and that's Yusha, right? Look at that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You're up there. You're up there. So, yeah.
This is presuming these are articles in English.
Right,
and would the
for us
material be in English? In terms of those most likely to be writing truly scholarly academic work.
You'll see, I have a slide on this.
Okay,
I was producing.
Great.
So, but I said if I was one of you, come this, I'm like, what is this, right? So I just put the search in, and this is what I get. So we got a few physicians, a PhD, and someone who's sort of duly trained in PhD and a physician. And you got some other papers in the sites here. You look at PubMed, right? So PubMed, that's the United States, we use PubMed. Physicians often use PubMed. And we say, okay, same search term, what do we find? The first six papers. Oh, so we have Farhad Muazzam again, a physician, PhD person. You have myself, Dr. Ghali. All right, PhD. You have Stefan van der Bruijden, who is a PhD in philosophy in the Netherlands. Then you have, not a physician, Burkhardt, I think, is a physician, maybe. You have Dr. Breslin here. This is a legal scholar, lawyer. And then you have Dr. Zahidi, who is from Iran, a physician. So obviously you're going to PubMed, which is a physician-dominated source. You got a lot of physicians here. But we did find an interloper, Dr. Lally, with a PhD speaking, in this one as well. Okay. Then you go to our trusty, you know, University of Chicago Library, and you say, okay, same terms, so what do I get? Now you introduce a new player here, Abdulaziz Sajidina, PhD, Islamics, formerly at UVA, now at George Mason University. You get Fahad Nazim again, So I guess she's a very big player. You guys should look who she is. Look up who she is and tell me on Sunday. Bob Mawson, you have... Peter Broad. So this is a book, nice compendium, from Principles of Healthy Ethics. And then you have this book here, Muslim Medical Ethics from Theater Practice, which is got cut off, but this is a collection from a conference that John Brockup at Penn State did, who's a PhD Islamist person. So far you've seen just these three engines. We've seen physicians and PhDs, right? We didn't see, not that this is representative, this is not representative, but we saw this group, and we saw PhDs, which is missing here, and Islamists. So I'll add that. I'm going to say that, that we are missing some people from here, as you see your list. We didn't see chaplains on this list. There were inpatients. There was a lawyer, actually, on that list. So we'll check that off. But we're missing this group. So this is a website for fatwas. It's a fatwa bank, right, where Muslims around the world that has multiple language capabilities. So this is the English language here, where Muslims go and ask questions, and a group of scholars or an individual scholar writes an answer. So a fatwa, a religious edict, non-binding legal opinion in the Sunni world. Okay? We talked about them here as religious scholars, but none of this was available in Google in the top, whatever, seven searches, and the other databases wouldn't make sense. Go ahead.
So all the people that we mentioned before, like all the healthcare professionals and things like that, were they in their documents and the writing that they did they include like bioethics with theology in it, like Islamic principles, or were they just talking about just like the ethics?
So hold that thought. With this thought, we're going to get to this in a second. Okay? So I just want to point out, so we shouldn't forget, there was scholars you guys didn't, but sometimes if people are just looking at the field, they may forget that much of what's occurring is at the question, the questioner and the answer giver level. Okay, then you have these groups, right? Islamic Organization of Medical Sciences and the Islamic Medical Ethics Committee of IMANA, where you have, in this one definitely, you have physicians and legal scholars coming together and putting forth their opinions and their perspectives. So you have at least two disciplines engaged. My critique would be that there's not enough disciplines, sociology, social work, patients. But at least you have now a cross-disciplinary dialogue. You have the IMANA Ethics Committee, of which I am a member, which sort of has physicians, okay? No legal scholars on that group. But yet they put things out, as we just mentioned, around what are the Islamic ethical perspectives. So now we know who's producing, we know there are a lot of consumers, and the question becomes, who is the expert? And so Dr. Rial is back there, sort of says, well, the expert would be the person who knows medicine and who knows Islamic law. Are there other people we think are experts from this list? Are they all experts? Is there differentiation? What do you all think? Is there an expert? You can't speak. No. No. You can't wait. Go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead. No. Go ahead.
I'm joking.
Go ahead, please.
No. Just to say, the first statement you put up.
Yes.
That he should be a physician and...
Dr. Rial said that, not me. He said it should be a physician who knows medicine and also at the same time someone who knows Islamic law. So in his mind, that's the ideal expert. I'm putting words in your mouth, but that's what I understood. And I'm not going to let him change that. Do you have something, do you think someone else is an expert?
No, it just qualifies that one, because otherwise we end up in dilemmas.
So you
somebody,
think that's...
Yeah. Somebody who has to be... Islamic ethics, somebody to be a theologian.
Yes.
Not an Islamic. He should be a theologian.
Okay.
In theological perspective.
Yes.
And medics.
Medicine. So you're adding not just law, but theology.
Theology. Theology.
All right. Good. Hold right there. Yes. Go ahead.
So I think there are experts and there are experts.
Okay.
In the sense that in the development of a relatively new field, there are going to be a lot of practitioners who will be asked these questions and will respond. But in the absence of a depth of scholarly literature, whether what's said constitutes true expertise is, I think, a little bit problematic.
Right.
So the field becomes more mature, a more scholarly literature develops, and then that's accessible to a broader group of people who I would call more translators than necessarily experts.
Very good. So I think that's perfect. That's perfect, right? So we have a field that's new. We have some people, physicians mainly writing or others writing, but as the field matures, there will be a discipline parameters will be set, right? Methods of reasoning will be negotiated, research methods will be developed, and then we get a fully robust field, right, that is not just a name. Right? So it's not Islamic bioethics. Yes?
We have to be careful.
Yes.
When we are thinking about the secular or Western concept of the religion, like a law. When, on a Western perspective, when you say a law, a lawyer, it's totally different from the Islamic perspective. Mm-hmm. In a sense that I look at it qualified, when I say a theologian, he is, by merit, a lawyer in theology.
Okay.
I mean, all means.
So my next talk will get into this.
Oh,
my next talk will get into this.
Okay.
Yeah? Okay. So you all wanted to jump ahead, which is good. So I can jump ahead as well. So here we go. Just want to highlight some pitfalls of looking at various expertise, okay? So if you think about Google, we all know Google is problematic. But, you know, looking at what they call in Muslim circles the Sheikh Google phenomenon, or Sheikh is a scholar. Sheikh Google. Religious scholar of Google. Right, it highlights a pitfall in equating basic literacy with scholarship. Right, to simply Google a topic, right, one may think of oneself as an expert, or at least act like one. Meaning that you just read what you know, or what you find, and then you say, now I'm an expert. So that's a problem of pitfall. The other issue here, I think, is really prominent, is that even when an article is written by a single author, often there are straw man attacks on other valid line perspectives. Right? So this is not scholarly writing. I was once invited to a talk at some college, which will not be named, and they called me and said, we want to give you a talk. I've never heard of this college. I said, how do you know? You give me a talk. Okay, very good. What do you want to give me a talk? Well, I'm going to talk. I want you to give a talk on Islamic bioethics. I said, how did you find me? I said, well, I went to Google. And we got a video. We thought you're a good guy. We should invite you. So I said, very interesting. So the problem is that in the past, scholarship would be, I'm going to look at a paper, potentially, look at the citations, see what this person's citing. Right? This is how we raise scholarship at a college level. It's not some talk in the community. But even in the academy, at times you're just Googling and seeing someone looks okay, looks nice, can speak English, you're a speaker. All right, so that's why I'm here. But anyways, so in any case, here is some of the data that you all wanted. So a friend of mine, Hassan Shadamani and Muhammad Khalid in Michigan, they looked at PubMed, all right, and they said, we're going to review all papers in a 55-year pattern. PubMed is obviously a physician's right, and the field of Islamic bioethics is new. So we're going to look at this and see who's writing, where they are at. I'll tell you that data in a second. So look, these two terms, they found 146 papers over a 55-year period, right, which I would say is low. So we have other studies that show that, obviously, Medline is mostly written by people who are in the Western part, quote-unquote, part of the world, English language dominant. If you compare the same to Jewish and Christian perspectives, you know, like magnitudes are order different, okay? The content, however, which is further interesting, from this 146, only 11 papers, so less than 10%, mentioned anything more than a one universal Islamic opinion. Only less than 11. Further, of that, so less than 2% here, right, mentioned any concepts or shows of Islamic law. Period. Mention. Not that they just mention. So the implication here is that, right, these writings are highly problematic. They lack any depth, I would say, and they're not going to meet your scholarly practical needs, right? They're just not. Yours, healthcare systems, patients, anybody's. This is problematic. Now, the question is asked where they're writing. So of this, 29, so the two major places where people wrote, 29 of these 146 came from countries, from Iran, okay? Like 38 came from the UK or the United States. Those are the top two. So of the Islamic bioethics material published in PubMed, Iran, which is a Shi'i country, it's going to be important because the way they think of things is very different than the Sunni world. 15% of Muslims in the world are Shi'i, okay? But they were the dominant force. Then you have UK and United States. Now, I know this is English language, right? So we can't get, we're going to say, well, you know, you have bias there. I understand that. But today, the lingua franca of scholarship is English. So all those Arab nations, what are they producing? And who's reading that material? Who's engaging with it? That's a problem. But this is a further problem. So, moving on. So I told you, right, Googling is a problem, looking at PubMed is a problem. Now this is physician data, which Dr. Mobile Dean wanted. Muslim physicians, United States, same survey. I'm not going to read those out, it hurts me.
So does this tell us that we were asking earlier, who wants to know about this? Does this, are this telling us that these Muslim physicians don't want to know?
You tell me. This is hypothesis generating work.
Or that they think they know already.
Maybe. Either. Right?
Or the thing that the Islamic scholars don't know anything, so they don't ask them. And then there's a disconnect as well between the Islamic scholarship and the general public,
yes,
because of the lack of their, you know, practical knowledge. Giving speeches or sermons is different, and actually, being practical is different.
I agree.
It's like a clinician. Clinician is different than any other entity.
Very good. I agree. I'm sorry,
he's
going to put some behind you first. Go ahead.
Yeah, and I have to agree with that. I think the accessibility of true scholarship is so limited that informs us a lot. Like,
if you're saying consult a jurist, and that's not going to be your local imam, or your local imam, people often probably find that they know less than the physicians in terms of putting together the medical and the, and how do you
access scholarship? It might be a
different
language, it might be
similar
Muslim
culture,
it might be.
So there's many hypotheses here. So whatever you say,
John, someone else, go ahead. So I'm not able to speak to the Islamic piece of this, but thinking about the Jewish and Catholic pieces, there may be a bit of a skew with people who go into medicine being maybe more likely to be skeptical of religion,
right,
as superstitious, mm-hmm, or in conflict with the way they're devoting their lives to science.
Yeah.
So they may almost bend over backwards not to look into this.
So let me give some more data points, okay? So you have a lot of hypotheses here. Maybe they'll clear some of them up. Okay, when we ask physicians from the sample, how versed are you in Islamic bioethics? 85% said they are very or pretty knowledgeable of Islamic bioethics. Okay? When you ask them religiosity, so on a scale of 1 to 10, 90% of the sample was above 8. When you ask them about religious importance in life, 70% or so, I think 60-something or 70%, said that it's Islam is the most important, not very, it's the most important part of my life. Over half attended mosque once. I'm sorry, not over half. It was, I think, over two-thirds attended a mosque at least once a week. So it was a Friday congregational prayer. Highly religious sample. Highly religious sample, right? Who thinks they know? Is what I think.
Well, the question actually is coming to more kind of the research of how many universities or colleges
access
outside here have something that is a course.
You have to be on this marketing video.
That's cool, but I can have an example.
It's just coming naturally. Are you getting all this?
Yes.
There's no pump.
It's an ongoing question and can tell you what is where these people are coming with their information from.
Very good. So you all are clamoring for further granularity, but you see the problem, right? This is the problem space, right? That we have a physician group. Oftentimes, you can think about in Chicago, yes, we have 400,000 Muslims and we have a lot of Muslim physicians. But you're sitting in Des Moines, Iowa, right? How many, well, not Des Moines, let's say Montana, right? How many Muslim physicians do you have? And there are cases, we can talk about today's discussion, where Muslim physicians are asked, right, by the hospital staff. They're not on the ethics committee, but they're asked, or they put on the ethics committee because they're Muslim, so they can speak with the Muslim voice, and you have this group being put there. All right, so I think this is a challenging problem. So the goal for us is, I want to move on, sorry, we're running a little short on time, but the goal for us is to actually have conversations between physicians and jurists, right, to not say, look, I think this is problematic. So say there's an imam
who actually wants to talk to a doctor, but he doesn't know anybody because they never talked to him. Right? You see, on the other hand, what if a man says, I need to know what it is this they're asking me for the religious ruling, but I don't know any doctors, so they never talk to me, never come to law school. So it's problems of both sides. I think you have to have them come together. So both people in Chicago, you might not recognize them, you might, but in any case. So when I think of science bioethics as a field that is emerging and developing, I think about it in this sort of way, all right? Where you have inputs and sources of partners. So this is going to talk, we're going to move to a talk on concepts and different sort of disciplines. From the Islamic perspective, I think you have information that's coming from Islamic law, right? Which these are terms here, Islamic law, fiqh and hukum. And concepts from theology, as Dr. Fitan was mentioning, right? So you have law as a practitioner, lawyers involved, thinking about permissibility. But you have theology that also informs law. But here, this is another discipline in itself. How do you understand normativity is what I want to say throughout this this meeting. And then we have ethics, Adab, and our expert here is Sartell back there, paper you should all read, just came out, Jamal Lattis, about Adab, right, so the idea of practical ethics, virtue, where is that coming? So these are, I think, the moral machinery of the Islamic tradition when thinking about Islamic ethics comes from here. These are the inputs. And there, but these are all informed by, in a certain sense, or upon these areas, okay? Clinical practice, right, is informed by these. Social science has to be informing these potentially in certain ways, but it also informs social science, medical science, philosophy. So all of these people are conversation partners, discursive partners for people who are of this tradition. And if you don't have that discourse, you have incompleteness, right? The rulings don't meet our understandings, they don't understand, the concepts are mismatched, no one knows what's going on, and then you have physicians thinking everything. Because no one else is showing me anything, so I'm better than you, right? The one-eyed man, like me, is king in the land of the blind. And I think that's what's occurring for this field. And our hope is to rectify the situation. So that is the end of lecture one. Question? I have a few minutes for questions. Go ahead, please.
I'll give you an example. Once I asked a scholar that it's permissible in a state of fasting, you know, to use the inhaler.
Yeah.
He said no.
Okay.
So I said, based on my limited religious knowledge, the woman is permitted to taste the food while fasting.
Mm.
Okay. So that is in grams, you know, and this is in micrograms, and it has no taste. No flavor, and also it is not giving you any energy. So I personally think it is okay, and the person can fast.
Very good.
He said, he changed opinion, he said, I think that is okay.
Great.
So basically, you know, there is a disconnect.
I think there's multiple issues there. Can this like, dissect something? Would you mind being in case? Would you mind if I dissect what you just said?
Sure.
Yeah? So you're saying that there was a dialogue that occurred that improved the opinion. Well, let me challenge that. Okay? So the definition of fasting, for many people in common sense, they think about fasting as laying off eating, drinking, and sexual intercourse during daylight hours. Yes? That's the lay understanding. For those who are Muslim, right? Okay. Is that the legal definition of fasting? No. The legal definition of fasting is anything that enters an orifice.
Orifice.
Okay? Ears, nose, mouth, your other orifices. Okay? Alright, now the definition of nourishment is not part of that, necessarily. Okay? So the way that legal scholars understood the legal context of what is a fast and not a fast depends on their understanding of what a fast is. It's not lay, this is specialized knowledge. That's what it is. Where does that come from? It actually comes from prophetic traditions about where he said this broke your fast, did break your fast. So, in what you said, so the question of aerosolized medicine, is it entering an orifice? So, then what would be the normative answer? Impermissible. Because the legal understanding is that's the definition of fasting. Your idea of nourishment has nothing to do with it. First. Second, then you said, well, women can taste food. Is that a legal? Okay, so very good. So, now we're going to talk about normativity, hukum, and we're going to talk about fatwa. So the context of what you just said is that there is a legal opinion that when a woman has a husband who is a tyrant, and is very important about his food is very important to him, that so that she prevents herself from being harmed, Huh? Because the food is not cooked to the way it should be cooked when he's going to break his fast, she's permitted to taste the morsel. That is a fatwa, a ruling in a context. What she did was take that out of context and say she's permitted. There's no permission. The ruling is not permission. In her context, things that were impermissible became permissible. Right? Exception to the rule, not normative, contingent. Okay, so now to make an analogy to contingency and normativity, you cannot. Do not equate. Problem. So that's the second. Now, you said, well, I talked to him and now he changed his ruling. So I don't know what to do with that. I don't know who you're talking to. But even I, who is not able to talk, can tell you that's a problem.
Well, I also noted that, you know, they allow IV fluids.
We can talk about these things. This is not, we can have another session on fasting. But my point for us is this. Look, okay, we have one-eyed men who are in the land of blind who think they're kings. But that one eye is not seeing behind and front anywhere. It's just, oh, I'm going to give an answer. That's the problem. And we should be more responsible with our ethics than that. We should be.
Absolutely.
All right. Go ahead. Sorry.
So in essence, is the issue at hand here the question of who are the experts? They sort of aren't right now, and so the physicians think they are.
Yeah, I think to an extent, but I think there's a lot of things, right? So there's issues of conceptually, there's discontinuity between religious scholarship and modernity, right? So you have people studying in seminaries who don't engage with, they still think about, and I was at a major conference, I thought medicine is cure. That's it, it's like surgery. Get rid of it. No idea of chronic disease management. Right? No, didn't think about it. It's all about simply as cure. That's what medicine is. So that's one discontinuity. On the other hand, you have discontinuity from the physicians. They have never, I'm not taking it, but they have never sat and learned their faith in an academic sense, or even a seminarian sense. So you have this sort of conceptual confusion. I know Islam, so I'm showing you all my thoughts. I know Islam because I heard someone give a sermon once, and what he said makes sense, and that's Islam. Or I read a book, right? But a simple error like that, where fasting is not, we're talking about fasting as a legal definition, right? Can have a huge ramification of what's occurring in this field. And that's why this program exists, to at least give us literacy, so we know what we don't know, right? So that's the first victory, know what you don't know. Because if you venture, this is life and death matter. I mean, I get calls, last night I got a page, from a religious scholar, literally yesterday, who said, you know, what about DNR? Can I do DNR? What about palliative care? This is a religious scholar. This is not someone who doesn't know his legal, but he just didn't understand these terms of medicine. Right? And because they're not talking. 79, whatever, 60, whatever. Huge person not talking to each other. So we want to remedy that situation. I'm going to give you, before we move on. Yes, before we move on here, so I want to kind of give you, I just gave you some disclaimers. So I'm going to give you these. A few things to fill out here about these individuals, okay? To know their biases. Alright, then we're going to stop. Since we have some time. So, religious scholars and their biases are, you're going to get this repeated today and tomorrow. Their biases are that if you're a clear legal scholar, your duty, your ethos is to remove the community from sin. Okay? You have a corpus of traditions, you have sources, texts, and the idea is if someone's asking me a question, right? I don't want them to venture into sin. So I'm going to do mental gymnastics and find some opinions so I can tell this person what you're doing contingently is okay. Like the tyrant, husband, right? Well, that's not the normal ruling, but that's the exception to the rule. But what you do when you look at their rulings, you'll find a lot of exceptions. To generate that back up to normativity is a problem. And their bias is to give exceptions all the time, right? So you have, and I'll give you, like, in diagrammatically, you say the law is here, right? So one scholar says, okay, I want to kind of move here. Next says, well, this person who's smarter than me was here. I can go here. Oh, wait a second. Wait, this scholar is here. I want to move here. Then you look at the text and you say, what happened down here? And then physicians say, well, look, you guys don't make sense. But what they're doing is trying to move the masses away from sin. One. Second, you have lawyers. Right? Lawyers looking at law. Doctor, and in the Islamic sense, lawyers would be muftis, actually. Islamic scholars. They're lawyers. They're not judges. They're lawyers. A lawyer and judge is very different. A lawyer makes a petition argument for why something is permissible. When you look at discourse in the Muslim world and fatwas, they're making their argument, their sources out there, right? But they're not judging. The judge is going to, well, this is actually makes sense. This is the best thing. They're not authoritative in that sense. In the Islamic world, you have, in the Muslim world, you have in certain places both lawyers and judges. So you have people write their opinions, Sadir write their opinions, make their arguments, and then there is a judgment put forth by the Babi. If you just look at the opinions, right, you might say there's a lot of latitude. But what's important in that context is what the judge said, the Babi. Not what the lawyer said. Physicians, our biases are many. Many, but we want to do best by the patient. Right? Physicians, we want to do best by the patient. We're indoctrinated in science. We're indoctrinated in fighting disease. Right? So our biases are very different, right? Because we want to, again, these guys want to make it permissible. We want to help the situation of the patient in front of us. So we're often going to try to weigh on saying there's more benefit in something than there's harm. Yesterday, the FDA approved a drug, right? We all talked about this, right? They rejected it 3 times. They rejected it 3 times because there was instances of hypotension, right? There were 3 times, but the 4th time, okay, it went through. It was a majority, it was 18-6 vote or something like that. I mean, so the FDA didn't approve it, sorry. The advisory panel for the FDA recommended that that drug be approved. So you think about it, when you're assessing harms and benefits, the physicians always in doctor and think there's more benefit in it, potentially. I think. That's our bias, not that it always happens all the time. We have to check that cognitive bias. Chaplains, chaplains in this case, in the Islamic Bible's case, we don't have any Muslim chaplains, right? Very few Muslim chaplains. That's not in the United States, we don't have any. In the UK, we have some more than here. And I will just tell you that the chaplains programs that exist in the United States do not give legal training to their graduates in any robust way. And those who are chaplains, right, have potentially, unless in some assessment, less literacy than those who are chaplains. So if you're thinking about the core competencies of a hospital chaplain in this hospital, you know, what are they? Who are they? What are they coming with? And you might get very different answers. Sometimes they're put on ethics committees as well, but they might have a very different sense of what Islam is not Islam. So there's a bias. There's not a bias, there's a deficit here. Patients, we will leave aside. Patient Islamic studies. So patient Islamic studies, not all of them. But you know, we think the academics are here, the Divinity School, the academic study of religion is supposed to be disembodied exercise, potentially, right? I think the thing bias here, Elizabeth, I'm trying very cautious, the Divinity School is back there. I like her a lot, so I have to be cautious of what I say. But the point here is that it's a very different experience for someone in seminary who's giving responses, right? Who's worried, has to worry about the person in front of them. They're called into accountability in front of the day of judgment because of the response they gave. Than a PhD pontificate. Okay? Is that alright, Elizabeth? Very different. I'm not saying that they're doing anything wrong, but the bias here is a bit different than that group, okay? And oftentimes you see in the literature, these guys, this group saying this guy, this group is knowing. But they're not in their shoes. Similarly, this group doesn't interact with this group. They don't read all the material from everybody in the world. They say, well, this is my school, this is my seminary, these are the people around me, this is what they say. So they're also disconnected. Alright, that's my timer. So, yes, go ahead. Go ahead.
So I just wanted to make a point about the first right and the use of first right to generate normative.
Yes.
I would agree to an extent that there are some first words that are quite, the question is so generic that actually you can take the body of first words that are, so for example, it's smoking, haram, and haram. So you can take the body of those first words and you can see the spectrum of.
So you're looking at fatwas to find that hukum. I'm going to tell you that's a cautious enterprise and one that might not ever get there. So you have fatwas that repeat what is a ruling in traditional texts. You'll say, that's a fatwa. Yes? But they're just giving you the hukum. They're saying, well, this is what is known from the classical law. But ijtihad, reasoning, and fatwas, there are other fatwas that go against the corpus. And what your capture strategy, search strategy is now, you might get, you, how will you distinguish? Unless you a priori know, here's where the classical manuals say is the ruling on this issue. And here's the reasoning that they employ to give a different ruling. You won't know. You just look at fatwas. And you will say, as you will in your talk, the majority of fatwas, right, say something. But that's, well, who cares what the majority say? The question for us is what, I think the essential question is, you know, how you follow the reasoning. And people from different stripes will be closer and say, I'm not going to issue a fatwa, I'm going to stick with what's already known, and we'll leave it be.
And some people go way out on the limb to say that I want to issue a ruling that's different from what before. It's up to their enterprise. And distinguishing that is a problem for us as a consumer, right? So you know this, because when you were at that meeting that I was at, you had established a man saying, I don't want to go into the Fuzzies. Who cares what the Fuzzies say? Right? Yes. Okay. All right. So we're going to break here. It's a little early for my talk. We're going to break here. You can get coffee, whatever else you want to do. And actually, I'm going to start early because, what I have time till? When's the next lecture start?
Yeah.
10:20, I think? Or is it 10:25? 10:30. So we're going to start at 10:25. 5 minutes early. Let's 5 minutes early. We'll start at 5 minutes early. All right.